Morning, guys. Okay, just to before going on, considering the downlink of the passive MIMO network, let me quickly wrap up what we have done seen yesterday together. So we have, first of all, identified the main goal of massive MIMO, which is to improve the spectral efficiency of a cell. The main idea, I mean the ultimate goal, is to maximize the area throughput. We can do that increasing the bandwidth, densifying the network, or increasing the spectral efficiency. Massive MIMO belongs to the category of technologies able to maximize the energy efficiency, the spectral efficiency. So we have previewed the concept of cellular networks, uplink and downlink with user equipment and base stations for each cell. We have emphasized the need of channel state information. Since massive MIMO is a special division multiple access technology which relies on the knowledge of channel state information, we have emphasized the need of estimating the channel at the base station, and this can be easily done since we assume to have transmit UEs with just one single transmit antenna. So in this case, sending pilots, I mean one pilot per antenna from the mobile to the base station is enough to estimate all the channels seen from the different antennas. And if we apply a TDD protocol, which looks like this one, this is a FDD protocol. So if we apply a TDD protocol, we can exploit the reciprocity of the channel and use the knowledge of the channel either for receiving the data and for transmitting the data in the downlink. And in doing this, the TDD protocol, if you plot the TDD protocol, I mean degrees of freedom of the TDD protocol with respect to the number of users and the number of antennas for a given time interval for training the network, the TDD protocol is scalable with respect to the number of antennas, while the FDD protocol is not. I mean the feasible region of the FDD protocol is just what we have here below the black curve. For the TDD protocol, we can actually increase the number of antennas without any problem for the channel estimation phase. Of course, the TDD protocol relies on the reciprocity of the channel, and you may know that even though the physical propagation channel is reciprocal, I mean between uplink and downlink, there is a major issue here. And the major issue here is given by the hardware. So even though the channel, I mean the physical channel, is reciprocal, but the transceiver at the mobile terminals and the transceiver at the base stations are not. So all the impairments that we have in the digital signal processing part into the radio frequency chains, they may actually destroy the reciprocity of the channel. So it's not so easy to guarantee the reciprocity of the channel in reality. That's why cellular networks are based on the FDD protocol, because the FDD protocol doesn't rely on the reciprocity of the channel, just the feedback from the UEs. But if we want to go for a TDD protocol, then we have to make the system uplink and downlink, they have to behave in the same way from a transceiver and hardware perspective. Okay? So it's a major problem for the implementation of a TDD protocol. Okay, then we have introduced the massive MIMO network, the canonical massive MIMO network. There are many different instances of massive MIMO. But this one is the canonical one, the one that was introduced in 2010. And it is basically a multi-carrier, multi-cell network based on a synchronous TDD protocol. Synchronous means that all the cells are in uplink and downlink at the same time. In practice, this is not going to happen because it's almost impossible to be synchronized. My cell cannot be synchronized in time with a cell which is, I don't know, far away, tens of kilometers away from my cell. In reality, so this is not going to happen. But for a finite coverage area, we can assume that this is going to happen. Or even though this is not going to happen, this is a worst case approximation of the reality. So we are analyzing the performance of the system within a worst case scenario, where all the cells are synchronized, so the interference that they generate to each other is the worst one. So we are considering the worst case because they are synchronized together, uplink and down. Then the canonical massive MIMO network makes use of many antennas. So we have a large number of antennas. And what I mean with large, I mean if you give me the number of users that are active in the cell, the number of antennas is bigger than the number of users. A factor of 10, 5 is usually the common ratio between M and K. In this setting, the base stations can operate, can actually decode and pre-code the signals in uplink and downlink using linear processing. There is no need for any non-linear processing techniques based on interference cancellation, because since I have all these degrees of freedom, I can use the degrees of freedom to remove the interference in an efficient way, and I don't need to take into account other techniques like the interference cancellation techniques, where I detect the data and then I remove the interference, reconstructing the interference from the data. Even though these techniques outperform linear processing in multi-user MIMO, there is no need for a canonical massive MIMO network to go for nonlinear processing. And the other point is that the base stations do not share any information. They operate individually. So they are not exchanging any data, they are not exchanging any channel state information. All base stations acquire the channel state information from the pilots and then use this kind of information, estimates, for decoding and pre-coding the signals. So there is no cooperation at all. So it's not a network, MIMO network, where the base stations can cooperate and together serve all the users in the network. Then I have emphasized the need of introducing a correlated fading channel model, because I mean the classical way to do the analysis is to consider uncorrelated relay fading. That's quite common and simple because you can simplify the analysis and can build many different spectral efficiency in pulse four, for example. But since we have a huge number of antennas and the propagation channel is based on a scattering model where we have many scatterers coming from different angle variables and so forth. So the correlated fading channel model is the right one to be included in the analysis of massive MIMO. And I define what I mean with correlated channel model. What I mean a Gaussian vector which is distributed as a Gaussian distribution with zero mean and covariance matrix given by the correlation between antennas. So this model is quite generic. So give me a correlation matrix and I can build this channel vector and do the analysis for the correlation matrix that you gave me. But there is a limiting assumption behind this model. And the limiting assumption is two, actually, limiting assumptions. One is the zero mean. It might happen that outside the channel has a non-zero mean. Because if I have a line of sight component, for example, I have a line of set component, this is going to modify the mean of the Gaussian distribution. Okay. But this one is a worst case approximation, worst case model. It just neglects the line of set component, and I do the analysis for zero mean Gaussian vectors. And then the other one is that the channel is not, in reality, Gaussian. It's a nice approximation, but it's not Gaussian. Although it's not Gaussian, I mean that all the analysis that I've done so far can be extended to the case where we have an arbitrary channel statistics. Okay. And this is what, and the reason is very simple, because if you concentrate on spectral efficiency or any other metrics, the first and second moments of the channel vectors are what they are, what we really need for the analysis. And it doesn't matter of the statistics of the channel, if I have the mean and the covariance matrix, I can do the analysis. Either a Gaussian channel, either any other channel with different distributions. I gave you an example of a correlated channel, which is called the scattering channel model, which is based on a uniform linear array at the base station and a UE surrounded by multiple buildings or objects where the signals reflect and come from the UE to the base station. Under this model, you can compute the covariance matrix in a very simple way, and you can do the analysis. This is the model that I have used in all the numerical results that I showed you yesterday. Then I have emphasized the pilot contamination problem, which is a common problem for any multi-user MIMO technology. But in massive MIMO, it's more dominant because we have a huge number of users within a cell, and we have to reuse the pilot codes in every cell. And I have also pointed out that the pilot contamination, which appears when I have two users using the same code, is a function of covariance matrices. The product of the two is going to define the impact of, to determine the impact of the pilot contamination problem. Yeah, just to give you an idea, if I have a user whose signal is coming from this angle of arrival, 30 degrees, then if there is another interfering user using the same pilot coming from this direction, this direction, this direction, this direction, if I have many antennas, I can reduce the pilot contamination effect. But if they overlap, meaning that if they are on top of each other, then they are basically spatially overlapped, and there is no way to separate the channels, and then the normalized mean squared error increases, and this is going to affect the channel estimates and the spectral efficiency of the network. And then we came to the spectral efficiency. So first of all, to analyze the spectral efficiency of a massive MIMO network, we need to compute the capacity. The capacity of a system with imperfect knowledge of the channels is not known. So it's an information theoretic result, which is not a result which is not available in the literature. So we need to resort to lower bounds. And a lower, pretty good lower bound that has been used very frequently in the literature of massive MIMO relies on considering the interference as Gaussian, which is not in reality. So if you consider the interference as Gaussian, then a lower bound of the capacity in the uplink takes this score, where the expectation has to be taken with respect to the distribution of the channel estimates. So you can see here that it's the expectation of the log 1 plus, and this is the effective SNR, which is a function of the received combining vector and the channel estimates. So once you have this SNR, you need to take the expectation with respect to the channel estimates. The pre-log factor here is something that we cannot neglect because measures the time that we spend in training. Okay. Indeed, this is the time for data transmission, and this is the dimension of the coherence block. So if I use all the coherence block for transmitting data, this ratio is 1, but I have no knowledge of the channel. Since I have to train the network, tau u, which is the time for the uplink transmission, is smaller than the coherence block, tau c, and then I have a pre-log factor loss that is going to decrease the spectral efficiency of the network.
Considering the
preferences
Gaussian, why is that lower
amount,
and does that
maximize
the capacity?
Yeah, it's, what do you mean? So if it's Gaussian?
Yeah, that's, you're saying that that's a lower amount.
Yeah, it's basically, it's a worst case approximation. If you say that the interference has no structure, meaning that it's a Gaussian random variable with a zero mean or covariance matrix, it's a worst case approximation, and then you are lower bounding the capacity of the network.
Any other kind of distribution would be
better, yeah. And just to emphasize, the up to now we are only able to compute lower bounds. There is no upper bound which is good enough to be used for the analysis of mass and volume. So we know how the lower bound behaves, but we don't know any good upper bound that may be used to describe the performance, the spectral efficiency of the network. Okay, so given this lower bound, which is only a function of channel estimates and pre-coding vectors, I show you that the optimal decoder is the what it's called multi-cell MC combining vector, and comes from the Rayleigh ratio. It's very simple, it's estimation theory, and it's going to take this form for any given channel estimates and powers of the transmitting users. So that this is the optimal, I mean the receiver maximizing the spectral, the lower bound, the capacity. And you can actually prove that it's also the receiver minimizing the mean-square error. That's why it's called mu mean-square error. It's combining vector. It's optimal, but it's complex. And it's complex for different reasons. One is this one. If I have many cells interfering to my base station, I need to estimate the channels of all the users in all the cells. So I need to get all this information from the pilots. So not only from you guys in my cell, but from all the other guys interfering to my cell to you guys. And then I need to get all the information to estimate all the covariance matrices. And when I have this knowledge, I can compute the combining vector and decode your signals. So the complexity is high. And evaluating the performance, analyzing the performance mathematically, is very complex. That's why alternative schemes based on single cell minimum mean squared error, regularized zero forcing, max marginal combining, and are the common decoding schemes used in the literature, because they're simpler and because they facilitate the analysis of the mathematical analysis of the network. And they do not require knowledge of the statistics of the channel. I told you, we can actually say that the statistics of the channel are given us for free. That's what we usually read in papers, but it's not totally true. Estimating the covariance matrix is a major issue here, but it's not so challenging as estimating the channel, the least intense channel, okay? Because they change slowly in time and so forth. You have constants in the frequency domain, and they just change in time slowly compared to least intense channels, the information. So the running example, and just to let you see how much the spectral efficiency of a massive MIMO network can be for the different schemes as a function of the number of antennas. For a given setting, here we have 10 users. So the spectral efficiency with 100 antennas, so the ratio is 10. For this setting, we have 50, more than, here we have 50 bit per second per hertz per cell. If you take an LTE system, in the uplink you have 2.8 bit per second per hertz per cell. So there is a factor, I mean more than 10, and yeah, more than almost 20. So we are really increasing the spectral efficiency by an order of magnitude compared to a 4G system. And that's the main goal of the technology. We are not increasing the bandwidth, we are not densifying the network, we are just increasing the spectral efficiency. And we are doing this in a good way. Since we are actually getting the 10 times more spectral efficiency than we need. If you give me 10 times more bandwidth and 10 times more densification, then in total I have increased the throughput by an order of 1,000, which is what Qualcomm believes to be what's going to happen in 10 years, 15 years from here. The optimal is the multi-cell MMC. The single cell MMC easier, so close to the regularized zero forcing approach, so they just perform almost the same. And then I have the maximum rational combining scheme, which is the simplest one, has the worst performance, but it's the simplest one, also from an implementation point of view and also from an analysis point of view. Okay, this is another bound compared to the other one. Has some advantages, and this bound is known as use and then forget bound. Marzetta used this term when introducing this lower bound, and the reason why it is called use and then forget bound is because the spectral efficiency takes more or less the same structure, so there is no expectation you see outside the law. The expectation is inside each third of the SINR, and it's taken with respect to the channel estimates and channel distributions. And it's called user and then forget because I have estimated the channel, I have this knowledge, I know how much H at is, but I'm not using H at in the computation of the spectral efficiency. You see here, there is no H at in the computation of the spectral efficiency. But it will come up when I take the expectation, take into account that the real channel and the estimated channel are uncorrelated and so forth. That you can express the real channel as a function of the estimated channel and the channel estimation errors. If you compute the expectation, then the channel estimate will appear in the SNR. So, this bound is less tight, so it's a lower bound of the lower bound that I showed you before. But the good thing is that it can be used with any combining scheme and any estimation. I forgot to say that the other one is valid only if you use MSC estimation for the channels. If you use any other estimator, like the least squared estimator, the other bound is not achievable, you need to use this one. Okay, so this one is valid for any combination, any combined scheme, and any channel estimation scheme. And it's very useful to compute closed forms. Closed forms, especially if you consider maximum ratio combining. If you consider maximum ratio combining, you can play with expectations at the denominator and numerator, and at the end, you get a nice closed expression, which is only a function of second order statistics of the channel. There is no instantaneous channel anymore. Only the covariance matrices appear in the expression of the SINR. And we can get some insights from this. Why is it useful? Because we can get some insights. The first one is that check the signal at the numerator. If you increase the number of antennas, you increase the signal power by a factor of n, because you're taking the trace of matrices which have dimension of n, the number of antennas. So this one increases as n. This one is constant because it's the ratio. This one increases as n, and this one is constant because there is no trace at all. So this is the signal. This is non-coherent interference coming from all the users not using the same pilots. And this is the coherent interference coming from all the users using the same pilot. So at the end of the day, I have... So the SNR behaves like this. I have a quantity that scales at within a denominator. Then I have a constant. I have a constant term, which is given by the non-coherent. Here is, I mean, if I increase n to infinity, I have something increasing with n, something which is constant, something which increases with n, and then I have a constant quantity. So if you take the ratio, then you get. N is very large, you get a constant. So no matter how many antennas you have at the base station, from this expression, which is exact, I mean, I'm computing the spectral efficiency for the lower bound, this expression is exact. So if I take the limit, so no matter how many antennas I have, I cannot improve the spectral efficiency of the network above this term, which depends on covariance matrices and powers, the length of the pilot book, and so forth. Okay. And this is valid for maximum ratio combining. I'll tell you more later today. Just to keep in mind.
What is the pilot book?
What's the pilot book? So the pilot book is the set of codes that we use for channel estimation. So for example, what Shademann codes? What Shademann codes? So if I have a lens, so the pilot code, if I have a suppose that I have 4 time slots for transmitting a pilot, and I have 4 users. So a very simple code is this one. It's a very simple code. So I'm using this pilot for you, this pilot for me, and this pilot for me. They are orthogonal pilots. And I'm using 4 pilots over 4 time slots orthogonal among each other. But that's very simple because this is going to be a TDMA system. If this is time, if this is the number of users, and this is time, this means that each of you is transmitting only in a single time slot. That's a pilot. Otherwise, you can go for any other orthogonal code like this one. These codes are orthogonal. Orthogonal in the sense if you compute the inner product of this column and the inner product with respect to this one. So it's phi 1 emission phi 2 is equal to 0. And it's basically 0 for E for any index I different from K. That's a pile of books. You can think of many different pile of books. In LTE, they use Zadok 2 sequences for the random access procedure.
So, like OFDM, with this estimation, then they put some channels for the channels.
In OFDM, they have a pilot code in the frequency domain.
Yeah.
So, it's like I have many. Subcarriers. And I use for transmitting my pilot code, for example, of order 4, here, 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 and here. And then you use these subcarriers, which are called pilot subcarriers, when you transmit your code. So you can transmit here 1, 1, 1, 1. And I can transmit on top of you with a different code. If the channel is constant, so if the channel here is constant, so this is your channel, this is my channel, and this is the subcarrier index. If the channel is constant, then the pilot code are orthogonal in the transmission phase, and they're orthogonal on the receiver side. But if you have selective frequency, the channel is frequency selective in OFDM anyway, but if the channels are different in the frequency domain, then even though we are orthogonal to each other as a receiver, your terminology is destroyed. That's why I introduced the concept of coherence block. In massive MIMO, we have a coherence block where the channel is constant, given in time and frequency. Then anything that is orthogonal at the transmitter is orthogonal at the receiver. Okay. And this is quite reasonable. In LTE, for example, the coherence block in the frequency domain, I think it's like 12 subcarriers. And in the time domain, 14 OFDM symbols in LTE.
What is the main consideration while designing a pilot code?
Okay, there is a huge literature on designing pilot codes, depending on what you want to do. So this is very simple, trivial. This one is also very simple. But for example, there's a vast literature on designing pilot codes for reducing the PAPR of the transmitter. Because when you transmit a pilot, you increase the power, and especially at the mobile, if you have a peak power, which is high, it's not so good. And then there are people studying the best pilot codes to minimize, for example, the PAPR. There are many different approaches. You can actually design the pilot code for minimizing the mean squared error of the channel estimation. That's also another. You can compute the mean squared error at the receiver as a function of the pilot code and design the pilot code to minimize the mean squared error. So it's a kind of degree of freedom that you have to improve the system performance. But it's not here. Let's take it for free. I mean, I'm not investigating this into the scenario. But there are many different ways, line of reasoning for designing pilot codes.
Excuse me, one question. If you have just one cell, And we have a number of the users in our research, which is massive amount of users. The capacity of the uplink, overall capacity.
The sum capacity.
Yes, sum of the capacity. Is going to be proportional to the number of the massive antennas and the number of the users as long as the pilot is not reused.
Yeah, that's correct.
So it means that we can increase the capacity of uplink as much as possible. I mean, putting loads and loads of users as long as we don't reuse the pilot.
But you're going to use the pilots. You want, you know why? So the number of pilots. So keep in mind this. I think I'll finish all of them. Okay. So keep in mind this. This is the coherence block. This is the coherence time, and this is the coherence bandwidth. So this is the time interval over which the channel is constant. And this is the frequency interval where the channel is constant. So here I have a single, each of you has a single coefficient, HK, it's constant. These two are given by the environment, by the mobile, by the velocity of the users, by the propagation of the signals. They are given. You cannot say I have a, I don't know, 2 seconds or 10 seconds of coherence time interval. This is given, and it's approximately between 0.1, 1, or 100 milliseconds, depending on the velocity of you guys and the propagation environment. So for example, indoor, this is quite large, outdoor, this is quite small. So these two are given. And then you, here you have a training phase. You need to train estimated channels, and then you have to transmit uplink. So assume that I'm just considering the uplink, even though here I need to have uplink and downlink. So, but assume that there is only uplink transmission. So there's a training phase and an uplink phase for data. So the training phase is tau p uplink. So the training phase is limited by the total number of samples that they have. So you cannot use more samples than the samples that they have in the coherence block. And since I have a limited time for training the network, I have a limited amount of users that I can allocate in the network. Of course, you can actually push this line up to here, but then there is no time for data transmission. And the pre-log factor in front of the spectral efficiency, I mean, of the expectation, is going to kill the spectral efficiency of the network. So your comment is correct. So you can actually have as many users you want as long as the channel is constant. So if you have a constant channel with an infinite coherence time, which is not going to happen in practice, you can serve as many users you want. You can increase the spectral efficiency as you want. Because at the end of the day, you can train the network and then use the rest of the time, which is infinite, for data transmission. But this is not going to happen. The number of users is limited by the coherence time, coherence bandwidth of the system.
So inevitably, we will reuse the pilots in a single cell.
Yeah. But no. Between different cells.
In one single cell, it may be, I mean, is it possible in a single cell that you want to use it and reuse the pilot?
Yeah, in a single cell, usually, if you make assumption of users not using the same pilot, that's fine. If you have 10 users, 20 users, 50 users in the cell, probably it's enough. I mean, these numbers are large enough to be allocated in the training phase. But if you go for more, if you have sensors, if you have, I don't know, hundreds or thousands of sensors, probably there is no way to train the network for all the sensors in the cell. Then you need to use the pilots within your cell.
Or schedule different.
Or scheduling the users, the sensors over different coherence blocks, which means different frequency, different subcarriers, or different time slots. So you can use TDMA or FDMA. Okay, so, yeah. Any other comment? I mean, this is a good point, actually. Okay, so let's go 45 minutes late into the downlink. So, this is the new part. So it's gonna be very easy if you have clear what happened in the uplink. So in the downlink, so we are in the downlink phase from the base station to the receiver. Consider the user K in cell J. So this is the symbol, this is the precoder, and this is the channel. I'm using the emission even though transpose would be enough, but the emission helps to simplify the expressions, but it doesn't make any difference here if you have a transpose or conjugate, then transpose, which is an emission operation. So, and I'm explaining the reciprocity of the channel. You see, I'm in the downlink, I'm using the same channel that I had in the uplink. So, this is the signal of interest for one of you guys, and this is the interference coming from the base station to you and from all the other base stations to you. So there's no interference from users. Now we are talking about base stations. The base stations are creating interference to you. And not only your base station J, but all base stations L in cell L. Okay, so if I want to decode this message, what kind of knowledge I need? For sure, I need to compensate this gain here. It's a complex number. I need to compensate this complex number. So I need to have knowledge of this complex number, which means that I have to estimate this complex number at the UE side. Okay. And this is called pre-coded channel because I have the channel and then the pre-coder vector. So I need this knowledge, and then I need knowledge of the interference plus the noise, because my intention is to recover this data symbol, and then to do that I need to have knowledge of at least the complex gain that I have in front of the data and the interference plus noise. So if I want to get this information at the mobile side, I need to send pilots. So if I send downlink pilots, I can estimate the pre-coded channel and the interference plus noise. But this is not what we do in massive MIMO. We can do that, but there is no need. And there is no need, you know why? Thanks to the large number of antennas that I have at the base station, I can take advantage of the channel hardening property of massive MIMO, which allows me to replay, to approximate this pre-coded channel with the mean of the pre-coded channel. And the mean is a statistical value that you can easily compute at the receiver side, because it's going to be constant in time for a certain number of time intervals. So I'm not estimating any instantaneous pre-coded channel, but I'm estimating the mean of the pre-coded channel. And this is because I have many antennas, and I don't need to bother about downlink pilot transmissions. Okay?
Are we assuming that the So in the uplink, the user and base station, they already have the estimates of the channel.
Yeah.
So they don't anyway have to, I mean, once an uplink is done, the channel estimation has been done by the base station.
Yep.
And
it will be used.
So
here I'm at the mobile site. I'm saying what the mobile site, what the mobile user need to decode the signal and need this knowledge. But then there is the base station who has to design, which has to design the pre-coder, pre-coding vector, and this has to be done exploiting the knowledge of the channel estimates that I got from the uplink transmission, uplink training phase. I'll show you. So this is not the design of the base station, of the pre-coder vector. I'm just saying what kind of information the mobile terminal needs to decode the signal. And the only information that I need is this complex gain and interference plus noise knowledge. But thanks to the channel learning property, I can assume that these two are constant determined by the statistics of the channel. And if I do this, the capacity, if I do this, the capacity of the massive MIMO network in the downlink looks exactly as before in the uplink for the use and then forget about. The only difference here is that instead of having the receive combining vector, I have the pre-coding combining vector. It looks like the same, but there is a major difference. And the major difference is that here I have the channel of, I have the channel from all the base stations to one of you. And all the pre-coding vectors from all the base stations to one of you. So it's not like in the uplink where the receive combining vector is just one. I mean, my receive combining vector is just one for all the interference coming in the cell. Here, the interference depends on the pre-coding vectors used by all the other base stations. And then, the design of the optimal pre-coder vector is a very challenging task. So we don't know what's the optimal strategy in the downlink for pre-coding the signal. Because it's not like the Rayleigh ratio that we had in the uplink and that we obtain thanks to the fact that if I user K in cell J, what I get something like this. For the uplink, I have the same receive combining vector, and then the maximization of this ratio is very well known. Here, I cannot take out any pre-coder because they are a function of cell index and user index in that cell. Okay, so the spectral efficiency depends on all pre-coding vectors, and there is no obvious solution for the optimal pre-coding strategy. Okay. So from information theory perspective, just to let you, do you know what's the optimal strategy in multi-user MIMO? If you have perfect knowledge of channels, interference, and whatsoever in the downlink. So that this is the best paper award in information theory from Shlomo Shammai.
Yes, the best user development, the user with the best channel.
This one is the one with Kaire from a few years ago.
No, after Telkar and Shammai, they had the paper in which they do water filling across the channel states.
No, it's not multi-user now. Do you know deep paper coding? Do you know deep paper coding? So deep paper coding, if you have knowledge of interference at the transmitter, the base station, you can cancel out the interference the base station such that the users are not getting any interference. But in this case, it's the capacity achieving coding scheme But it's very complex in practice. There is no practical way to approach a DFT paper coding performance with classical codes. Tomlinson and Ashman, for example, pre-coding scheme is one of the possible solutions if you have ever seen this. It was very fancy. DFT paper coding was very fancy, I mean, 5 years ago, before Massive MIMO, because at that time, the setting was this one. And if the ratio is more or less the same, linear processing is not the, there's no way to get good performance with linear processing. You need to go for non-linear techniques. And the DFT paper coding is a kind of interference cancellation technique that you implement not on the receiver side, but at the base station. And it's the optimal strategy in terms of capacity. But it's not doable if you have imperfect knowledge of the channels, and it's not doable to have knowledge of the interference that I will create to all of you, and which will come from all the other base stations. There is no way to get this knowledge at the base station. Okay. But from an information creative point of view, DFT paper coding is the optimal, is the capacity achieving strategy in multi-user MIMO in the DAO. Okay. Anyway, since here we are in the other setting, linear pre-coding is a good choice. And so the question is how can I design the pre-coding vectors, since it's not so trivial. So the answer is not known. So we don't know how to design the pre-coding vectors in a massive MIMO network. What we do, we simply use maximum regression combining. They use in the first place maximum regression combining. And if you use maximum regression combining, you can compute the expectations. So there is a small difference here. If you see the pre-coding vector is channel, estimate of channel, and then there is a normalization. You know why there is a normalization? And I didn't have this normalization in the receiver, at the receiver side for detecting the signal. You know why in the downlink we need to normalize the power? The pre-coding vector. Not power.
For the device. Because the device is more
mm-hmm. In any downlink scheme, why do I need to include here scaling factor? Why didn't bother about the scaling factor in the output? It's very simple. This is the base station.
Okay.
It's the base station transmitting. And W is the pre-coder that I'm using the base station. That's very simple. I mean, you guys are working on energy efficiency or power efficiency. Why should I normalize the pre-coding vector? Because in reality, the base station has a limited amount of power. If you remove this normalization, the pre-coder is going to be a function of the channel. And if the channel is very weak, then I need a lot of power to compensate the channel. And then it's gonna blow up my base station. That's why in the uplink, you need to constrain the transmit power. That's very, very simple. If I want to transmit to you close to me, and the channel is good, so I probably need not so much power. I can invert the channel, for example. And the power is not so much. But if I had to serve a guy, I don't know, the cell edge, then if you invert the channel, you can do that, the power goes up.
I thought it was the other way around. The mobile devices have lower power, so maybe
they do, but in the uplink, they use a given power. So if all the analysis they have done, that I have done, I assume that the user is using given power. For example, in the example, they use 0.1 watt. So they use the same power, 0.1 watt, which is nothing. Nothing. It's a very small power level. No, they're not considering this. So in this example here, okay, there is no power here. So in this example, any UE in the network is using the same power, 0.1 watt. Doesn't make any difference if you are close or far away from the base station. You know why? Even though you're transmitting with a very low powered level and you are cell edge, since I have many antennas, at the end of the day, I have a huge array gain which can compensate the low power level that I get from you. And the other thing is that the optimal precoder and the optimal receiver is a function of the power levels. It's a kind of receiver that tries to compensate the fact that if you are close to me, yeah, if they're the same power, you just, these guys are all the same.
If you, the benefits to the benefit of the UE.
Yeah, the UE can use any power, so I'll show you another interesting result of massive MIMO, that you can reduce the power as much as you want as the number of antennas increases.
But won't channel hardening also do the same effect in the downlink?
The channel hardening?
Yes,
in the down, so at your side, but at my side, there is no hardening. I don't see, at my side, just precoding the signal, and the hardening is going to happen because transmitting the signal, I get this inner product. This is the hardening effect. But at the transmitter, there is no hardening at all. So you need to normalize. You need to normalize the precoder just to ensure that you're not using a lot of power. Okay. Indeed, the expected norm of the precoded vector is equal to 1. Okay. So if you can do the expected norm, so the average power for each user at the base station, if I use that normalization, I get 1. It's very simple. You replace, and then you get 1. Okay, so if you replace the precoding vector into the lower bound, as for the uplink, we can compute closed forms, and we can get insights. And the insights are more or less the same as in the uplink. The signal power grows with n. The non-coherent interference is a fixed quantity with n. The coherent interference coming from the users using the same pilot, and then I build the transmit precoding vector, and then I go in this direction. So I create some pilot contamination effect. It's going to be an increasing function of the number of antennas, and then I have the noise, which is a constant quantity. So as before. But it's not precisely the same. It's not precisely the same. So consider two UEs. This is the user of interest, and this is an interfering guy using the same pilot. Let's consider the uplink. So in the uplink, so this guy is transmitting to the base station, and this guy is transmitting to its own base station, the other one. So I get interference from here, and he's getting interference from here. What do you think is going to happen? Who is going to suffer more from the interference created by the pilot contaminating user. This one or this one? Make a guess. You say this one, he says the other one. So why this one for you? No, I mean the power is fixed. Same power. Yeah, just me using the same power. There's no power location here. Consider a simple case where all the UEs are transmitting with the same power level. Why? So I'll give you the answer. You give me the motivation. So this one has worse performance than this one. So it's more affected by the interference, this one, than this one. You tell me why. Geographically, especially, think about the spatial directions of received signals. So consider this guy. This guy is transmitting and is getting the interference from another guy, which is far away from the base station, but they do have more or less the same covariance matrix, because the difference of the angle of arrivals is the same, more or less the same. So it's small. Then this means they're not spatially separated enough to be separated in the decoding process. But on the other hand, this one is receiving the interference, but the spatial separation between the two is pretty good. So in the end, I can actually guess that the performance of this one is not largely affected by the performance of the other UE. And what happened in the downlink? I mean, from the spectral efficiency expression, it looks like more or less the same conclusions can be drawn for uplink and downlink. Okay, so this is the uplink. And this is the UEs with worse performance in the uplink. What's going to happen in the downlink? Vice versa. Why? Because in the downlink, check this UE. It's getting the interference from the base stations. It's not getting the interference from any UE because we are in the downlink. And it's getting the interference from this base station and these base stations, which are separated, spatially speaking. And then this kind of interference can be mitigated in a good way, in an easy way. The other guy, which was in a good condition in the uplink, is not in the downlink because he's getting the interference from this one and this one. No, sorry. This one is the lucky guy. So it was not so lucky here, but it's now the lucky guy. Here, the interference is quite well separated as well, so there is no problem. So my UE of interest is not so lucky in the uplink, but it's lucky in the downlink. This one is lucky in both cases. So even though they look very similar, uplink and downlink, due to the spatial distribution of the users, if you have a correlated fading channel model, things may change. If you have uncorrelated relay fading, there is basically no difference between uplink and downlink. But this is not going to happen in reality. Okay. Yeah, just to... The pilot contamination in the uplink is easy to understand. Because if I get the pilots coming from you, if there are two guys using the same pilot, I get a pilot contamination. But in the Darling, what really means to have pilot contamination? I mean, destination phase is over. Why pilot contamination is an issue in the Darling? Because, so this is the uplink phase. They are transmitting pilots, and I get channel estimates. I know that there is a guy here, specially speaking, and I know that there is a guy here, specially speaking. Then in the downlink, this base station is transmitting the signal towards the guy of interest, so this one. So it's using the estimate of the channel to point the signal into the direction of the user interest. But since this channel estimate is contaminated by this guy, at the end what happens is that I'm not pointing the signal only in this direction, but also in this direction. So it's like a beamforming scheme, if you want. You point in that direction, but at the same time, along the direction of another UE using the same pilot, because for you, they're the same. Okay. But taking advantage of the different positions of the users and the correlated predicated model, we can mitigate this interference in the Darling too, not only in the uplink. Okay, so the expressions of uplink and downlink are basically the same. So if you compare the two, once you normalize the precoding vectors, are basically the same, mathematically speaking. Practically speaking, the performance of the system is different. Now, since they are basically the same, what I think I'm going to show you. Do you know the uplink and downlink duality? Have you ever heard about the uplink and downlink duality? So the uplink and downlink duality was a very well-known result in multi-user MIMO under this setting, which basically means that I can get the same spectral efficiency in the uplink, in the downlink. So there is no difference. I can guarantee to have the same spectral efficiency in uplink and downlink. Can I prove this result in massive MIMO, where I'm taking advantage of the channel hardening and new spectral efficiencies, bounds, and so forth? Yes, and that's very simple, because since they are basically the same, you impose the equality of downlink and uplink, you solve the problem, and you get a duality in the downlink. So you can achieve the same performance in the downlink as the ones that we had in the uplink. Anyway, just keep this in mind. So since I don't know how to design the precoder vector, I don't know what's the optimal strategy. I take advantage of this duality result, and I use in the downlink what I used before in the uplink. That's very easy, and it's a very reasonable choice. So in the downlink, I use the maximum ratio transmit precoding vector before, but I can use the zero forcing, regularized zero forcing, single cell, multi-cell. But I need to normalize everything. Instead of the average, you may think of normalizing by the sinus power. So the difference is that in this case, I ensure that the expected, the average transmit power is 1. If I normalize by the instantaneous realization of the precoding of the receive combining vector, what's going to happen? It's going to happen that the transmit power is 1 instantaneously, not on average. Instantaneously, my power is 1. Otherwise, in this case, this case, if you plot the power, it's something like this. So on average, it's fine, but instantaneous, they can be any number. Okay, so so we designed the network in the downlink, taking advantage of the uplink and downlink duality. And these are the performance that we have in the universal pilot use setting, where the pilot use is one. Once again, increasing the number of antennas, this one is the worst one, and then I have, they perform more or less the same because of the setting. And if you compare the spectral efficiency with LTE, in LTE you have roughly 3.2 bit per second per hertz per cell. Here you have 35. So one, 10 times more spectral efficiency with this technology. And if you increase the pilot reuse, the MSC is better, but the maximum ratio combining is slightly worse because of the pre-lock factor reducing the spectral efficiency. Just to wrap up, if you consider the case with 100 antennas and the different schemes with different pilot view spectrums, it turns out that the optimal one for maximum ratio combining for this particular setting, I'm not saying that it's going to be the result for any kind of setting. For this setting, pilot views one is the optimal one for maximum ratio transmit pre-coding. And then the pilot view spectrum two is the best one for any other combining. Okay, so let me jump into the asymptotic analysis. I have talked about the asymptotic analysis during these two three classes actually. But let's do it in a rigorous way. And when I say asymptotics, I say assume that the number of antennas goes to infinity. I have an extremely large number of antennas. So I'm operating in this setting here. Oh, there is no practical sense to assume that we have an infinite number of antennas because this is not going to happen. Any base station will have a finite number of antennas. But it's interesting to get some insights into the performance of the system. What we really mean with an infinite number of antennas, we mean an operating regime where this ratio is very large. So whenever you see a paper on the asymptotic analysis of massive MIMO, you need to think of this regime as a regime where basically the number of antennas is hundreds larger than the number of users. We're close to the infinite regime, okay? So no one believes that antenna base stations will have an infinite number of antennas. No one. Even in millimeter wave. Okay? It's not going to happen in the 6 gigahertz bands, but it's not going to happen either in the millimeter wave bands, even though probably instead of 100, we might have 1,000 or 5,000 antennas in the millimeter wave bands. No one believes to have an infinite number of antennas. Okay, for doing the analysis, we need to impose two assumptions, mathematically important. So the first one is, okay, I'm not talking about the limit, so probably you know or probably you don't. But so we need these two assumptions, and what they mean in practice. So the first one, assume that you have uncorrelated relay failing. If you have uncorrelated relay failing, the covariance matrix is this one. If you substitute this expression here into the first condition, what do you get? You get the limit, okay? Anyway, the limit of is equal to, okay, you take the trace is this condition. Then mj, you have mj here, and then they cancel out. Practically speaking, when you have a different covariance matrix, means that we assume that if we increase the number of antennas, we collect more energy. So we are not constrained the number of antennas, the base station, within a finite size array. We increase the number of antennas and we collect more energy. More energy, more energy, more energy. Okay? For example, this is the case of uncorrelated precipitation. And the second assumption is that there is no eigenvalue of the covariance matrix that grows unbounded. So there is no infinite eigenvalue in the covariance matrix of the channels. Okay. So they're really reasonable assumptions. Probably not the first one, because the array can be long, very, very huge, but cannot be infinite. At the end of the day, if you have an infinite number of antennas, you are not going to collect an infinite energy. You can for sure not collect more energy than the one that you have transmitted. Okay? But in this case, since the path loss is minus 6 dB, minus 120 dB, you need billions of antennas to collect more power than you have transmitted. Okay, so take the two conditions for free. They are correct for the analysis. We need these kind of conditions for the analysis. And then we define the concept of linearly independent covariance matrices. I'm not talking about orthogonal covariance matrices here. I'm talking about linearly independent covariance matrices. And to figure out what's the difference, so probably with matrices it's not so easy, but with vectors it's pretty much easy. So if I have a vector H, a linearly independent vector is any vector which goes in this direction. And if I have many vectors, this is the condition for, if you replace here H instead of the covariance matrix, and then here you have HI, this is the condition for linearly independent vectors. You can extend this condition to matrices in this way, taking the Frobenius norm. So this is the Frobenius norm, which is the trace of a matrix A is the trace of AH, and then the square root. Okay, so yeah, square. So this is the linearly independent condition for matrices. So assume that we have linearly independent matrices. And then we extend the concept to asymptotically linearly independent matrices, which means that if you take the limit of this quantity is bigger than zero. So no matter what I do at the base station, no matter how many antennas I have, let's assume that the covariance matrices are linear, asymptotically linearly independent. Okay. Now, this condition does not imply this condition. And I'll show you in a second. Okay, let's consider two covariance matrices. Very simple, a very simple example. So we have the identity matrix, and then we have the same matrix, but scaling factor here. See? So the two matrices are linearly independent for any integer n prime. It's very easy to prove it. So they are linearly independent for any integer n prime. Okay, let's consider the asymptotically linearly independent condition. So I need to compute the trace. I mean the Frobenius norm of f. It's very easy. So it's going to be this function. And then this function has to be minimized with respect to C1, because the condition has to hold for any C1 coefficient. So I compute, I minimize this function with respect to C1, and I get this. Okay, this is the Frobenius norm of the difference. As you can see, is bigger than zero for any n prime. So basically, they are linearly independent. Let's take the limit. If you take the limit, what do you get? If you take the limit with respect to n, you get zero. So even though you have linearly independent covariance matrices, you let the number of antennas grow, and this limit is going to zero. But if I replace n prime with alpha n, where alpha is any number between 0 and 1, the ratio, the limiting case, we have n minus n prime, divided n squared. If I replace n prime with alpha n, I get 1 minus alpha m squared. This is larger than 0 for any alpha between 0 and 1. This is just to give you an example that you have, if you have two linearly independent covariance matrices, this is not going to happen in the asymptotic regime. It's not going to hold in the asymptotic regime. You need to scale properly, for example, in this case, m prime. Physically, practically speaking, means that the subspace, think about vectors, the subspace where they are linearly independent grows with a dimension which is proportional to n. Since you are taking the limit and dividing by n, the subspace where they are linearly independent has to grow with n. If it grows with n, then they are asymptotically linearly independent. If this subspace is constant, then they are not asymptotically linearly independent, even though they are for any finite. Okay, so the point here is that, do we have this condition in practice, or we are talking about conditions which are not going to hold in practice? So take a very simple example, the simplest one. The simplest one is, assume that you have two covariance matrices, identity matrices, which is basically the uncorrelated gradient fading when the path was this one. I have two covariance matrices, identity matrices, and assume that we have a small perturbation, very small perturbation, on a covariance matrix, which means that I have one base station and the other one covariance matrix and the other one. They're the same identity matrices, but then I measure for some imperfections. Have some imperfections along the mean diagonal of the covariance matrix. So these are random positive random variables. Okay, have a very small perturbation. Let me compute the Frobenius norm squared. So this is the Frobenius norm, very simple. You take the difference, C1. Then, since I have a large number of antennas, an infinite number of antennas, I can replace the sum with the expectation, and I get this. This can be lower bounded by what? By the variance of the random variables. And by definition, the variance of positive random variables is positive. So, I was in a setting where the covariance matrices were not linearly dependent. I have introduced some perturbation, very simple perturbation that can for sure happen in practical systems. And with this small perturbation, the asymptotic linearly independent condition holds. So the answer to the question, is this a practical assumption? Yes, it is. It's a very practical, it's going to happen. It's going to happen in practice if you implement a massive MIMO base station. Because nothing, it's impossible to have two identity matrices, same matrices for any guy in the network. Even though they are, because of the propagation environment, then you have the imperfections at the base stations. They're going to change all the elements, and then in the end, they're going to be spatially, linearly independent in this asymptotic region. Okay, I think I'll stop here.
Thank you.